In 1944, as the Germans faced a deteriorating situation on all fronts, the Luftwaffe found itself struggling to defend crucial German industrial and civilian centers against relentless Allied bombing. Despite resource and manpower limitations, the Germans were not short on ideas for a miraculous turnaround. However, many of these never progressed beyond the drawing board. Among those proposals was the concept of a cost-effective, mass-produced fighter aircraft, which would materialize as the HE-162 Volksjäger, commonly referred to as the People's Fighter. This project not only aimed to develop an affordable jet fighter, but also intended to utilize Hitler Youth members as pilots. The individuals credited with the development of the Volksjäger concept were civil engineer Karl Otto Sauer and Generaloberst Alfred Keller. By 1944, Sauer had recognized the dire situation faced by the Luftwaffe and believed that a cost-effective and easily producible jet fighter could potentially shift the tide of war in Germany's favor. He wasted no time in presenting his idea to Hermann Göring, who readily embraced it. Meanwhile, Generaloberst Alfred Keller, responsible for flying, training, and sports association, put forth his own proposal to employ young boys between the ages of 15 and 17 as pilots for the mass-produced fighter. However, Keller faced significant opposition, as many within the Luftwaffe and Nazi leadership considered the idea reckless and irresponsible, given the inexperience of the potential pilots. Despite the criticism, Keller remained steadfast in his proposal, arguing that the young boys could be trained quickly and would be highly motivated to defend their homeland. However, Hermann Göring, who had fallen out of favor with Hitler, was eager to regain his trust and sought a means to appease the Führer. He saw a potential miraculous solution that could revive the Luftwaffe and put an end to the relentless Allied bombing campaign on Germany in Sauer's and Keller's proposals. From a psychological perspective, these proposals appear to offer an ideal solution to Göring's desperate quest for redemption. In September 1944, the German Air Ministry, Reichsluftfahrtministerium, RLM, issued the project requirement to German aircraft manufacturers. These requirements included utilizing the BMW 003 jet engine, achieving a minimum speed of 750 km per hour at sea level, possessing a flight endurance of 30 minutes, and equipping the aircraft with either two 2-centimeter or 3-centimeter cannons. The primary construction material was to be wood, with a lesser amount of steel. The aircraft manufacturers were given an extremely demanding deadline of just a few days to submit their initial proposals, creating an absurdly tight time frame for development. Heinkel, Arado, Blom & Voss, Junkers, and Fugger Wolf were among the companies that responded to the project requirements. However, Messerschmitt chose not to participate, as Willy Messerschmitt was opposed to the concept from the outset. Once the competition period ended, all proposals were submitted to the RLM. A conference was held in Berlin, attended by representatives from the 5 companies, as well as officials from the Luftwaffe and RLM. Upon evaluation, the Arado, Fokker Wolf, and Junkers projects were immediately rejected. Heinkel's original proposal also faced the possibility of rejection due to its complexity in construction. Ultimately, the Blom & Voss project was deemed the most favorable due to its simplicity. However, Heinkel's representatives made efforts to win the competition by highlighting their available production capacity resulting from the cancellation of the HE-177 and HE-219 programs. They also proposed simplifying the entire design to facilitate mass production. The final discussion and decision regarding the competition took place at Hitler's residence in Rastenburg, East Prussia. With the backing of Hitler and Göring, along with Heinkel's demonstrated production capabilities and experience, the Heinkel project emerged as the winner. As per the original plan, the first mock-up was completed by October 1, 1944, and the construction of the first prototype was scheduled to begin by December 10th of the same year. The main production of the aircraft was slated to commence in January 1945, aiming to produce 1,000 fighters per month initially, with the goal of eventually increasing the monthly production to 2,000 units. According to Ernst Heinkel, the intended final designation for the new Volksjäger was HE-500. However, in an effort to conceal its original purpose from Allied intelligence, RLM officials assigned it the designation 8-162, which later evolved into HE-162. The responsibility for the final design of the HE-162 was assigned to engineers Siegfried Günther and Karl Schwertzler. They led a sizable design team consisting of approximately 370 individuals. The design process took place at the Heinkel workshop located near Vienna. The HE-162 was characterized by its simple fuselage construction. Employing an inexpensive and lightweight metal alloy for most of its structure, the nose section featured a plywood covering, while the main fuselage was built as a semi-monocoque design and covered with duralumin. The wings, on the other hand, were constructed using wood and attached to the central fuselage using 4 bolts. To support its ground operations, the HE-162 featured a tricycle landing gear configuration, with a single wheel position at the front and 2 additional wheels situated in the center of the fuselage. The pilot seat of the HE-162 followed a straightforward design, yet it incorporated an innovative feature, Heinkel's ejection system, combined with a parachute. Remarkably, the HE-162 was among the pioneering German aircraft to be equipped with an ejection seat as standard equipment. For the HE-162, the BMW 003E turbojet engine was selected and positioned in a nacelle located above the central fuselage. However, the engine posed certain challenges as its estimated life cycle was only 50 hours. To protect the fuselage from potential damage caused by exhaust gases, a steel plate was installed beneath the jet nozzle. By October 15, 1944, the initial sketches and production tools for the HE-162 were prepared. To accelerate production, additional factories and smaller companies were enlisted to manufacture specific parts and components. The plan involved transporting these parts to Vienna for final assembly. However, this approach faced significant challenges due to the poor quality of the delivered parts. Numerous issues arose, including non-compliance with production regulations, substandard glue, and ill-fitting components. Transport-related damage also affected the prototype's engine, necessitating repairs. Despite these setbacks, all the required parts eventually arrived by late November, enabling the commencement of the assembly process for the first HE-162 prototype. The HE-162 V1 prototype was completed and ready for testing on December 1, 1944. However, stability issues caused a delay in the planned maiden test flight, which eventually took place on December 6. Flugkapitän Gotthold Peter, Heinkel's main test pilot, piloted the aircraft during this approximately 20-minute flight, reaching speeds of 300 km per hour without encountering major problems. Another flight was conducted on December 10th for Luftwaffe officials, during which the pilot performed a low pass at an impressive speed of 735 km per hour to impress the spectators. Unfortunately, during the maneuver, a part of the wing failed, causing the aircraft to crash and resulting in the pilot's death. Following this tragic accident, other pilots were hesitant to fly the HE-162. To encourage test flights, Ernst Heinkel offered a reward of 80,000 Reichsmarks to pilots willing to fly the aircraft. Karl Franke accepted the offer and performed the first test flight with the second prototype on December 22, 1944. In order to address the stability issues, renowned aircraft designer Alexander Lippisch was consulted. Lippisch proposed fitting small extensions to the wingtips as a means to improve the HE-162's stability. The plans to begin mass production of the HE-162 in early 1945 faced significant challenges and were not fully realized. The prevailing chaos in Germany during that time resulted in numerous delays in the delivery of necessary parts. The scarcity of fuel and transport vehicles, coupled with the persistent Allied bombing and raids targeting industrial facilities, further hindered the production process. Additionally, the utilization of forced labor under unfavorable conditions contributed to the overall difficulties faced in manufacturing the HE-162. The construction of each HE-162 aircraft required approximately 750 man-hours, while the engine production required an additional 300 man-hours. Despite the slow production progress, Hitler issued an order on March 27, 1945, for the SS to assume control over the entire Volksjäger project. However, this intervention had only a limited impact on accelerating the production process. The production of the first operational aircraft, the HE-162 A-1 and A-2, was delayed until the end of March 1945. The main difference between these variants was the armament, with the A-1 equipped with two 3cm cannons and the A-2 armed with two 2cm cannons. The exact total production numbers vary depending on sources, ranging from 116 to 270 aircraft. Additionally, approximately 800 aircraft were found in various stages of factory assembly. On the 7th of April 1945, Hitler ordered the halt of further development and production of the HE-162 in favor of the ME-262. However, it is unclear if this order was fully implemented, as production of the HE-162 continued until the end of the war. Delivery of HE-162 fighters to Luftwaffe front units faced limitations due to various factors such as slow production, fuel and spare part shortages, and the advancing Allied forces. Despite these challenges, a few units were eventually equipped with the HE-162 aircraft. The initial operational unit to receive the HE-162 was a test unit Erprobungskommando 162 comprising experienced German pilots. Their primary objective was to gain proficiency in flying the HE-162 and serve as a basis for forming operational units. However, due to the scarcity of HE-162 training aircraft, temporary measures involving gliders and older planes were implemented. Unfortunately, the training progress did not meet expectations, and the performance of the first group of young pilots was underwhelming. Consequently, the plan to utilize young Hitler youth as pilots was abandoned, as it became evident that even experienced aviators found the HE-162 difficult to handle. To establish the first operational combat unit with the HE-162, the choice fell upon Jagdgeschwader 1, JG-1, an already experienced unit. JG-1 was provided with a number of HE-162 aircraft, primarily prototypes for training purposes. Plans were in place to form additional units, but the deteriorating war situation in Germany prevented their realization. Another unit that received a few HE-162 was the Ergänzungsjagdgeschwader 2, a training unit. However, it is uncertain whether these aircraft were ever deployed in actual combat operations. By the end of March, JG-1 had received approximately 58 operational HE-162A-2 aircraft, and there were plans to deliver an additional 25 aircraft to the unit. However, due to the swift advance of the Allied forces, JG-1 was relocated to the Schleswig-Holstein region near the Danish border in April. On the 19th of April, an HE-162 was shot down by an American B-47 Thunderbolt shortly after takeoff, marking the first combat loss of the aircraft. On the 20th of April, the HE-162s were deployed on their first operational combat mission, targeting an RAF front airfield. However, during their approach, they encountered a group of Hawker Tempests that intercepted them. In the ensuing engagement, one HE-162 was shot down, but the pilot survived the incident without sustaining any injuries. The HE-162's first claimed air victory was credited to Rudolf Schmidt, who reportedly shot down a British fighter. However, it was later determined that the fighter was more likely downed by German ground anti-aircraft fire. As the Allied advance continued, JG-1 received orders on May 5, 1945, to cease all further actions and destroy the remaining operational aircraft. 3 days later, on May 8, the Lech airfield was captured by British forces, effectively bringing an end to the HE-162's brief operational combat history. After the conclusion of World War II, the Allies successfully captured a number of HE-162 aircraft. The British Technical Intelligence Team selected 11 planes for transport to the United Kingdom, where they underwent extensive examination and testing. The British also supplied some HE-162s to the Americans. Additionally, the American forces were able to obtain several abandoned HE-162s found throughout Germany. The French received or captured 5 HE-162s, two of which were in airworthy condition. As the Soviets advanced through Germany, they captured around 7 HE-162 aircraft, two of which were airworthy. These captured planes were meticulously tested and analyzed by the respective Allied nations to gather valuable information. The history of the HE-162 is a captivating tale. Considering its background, would you have been willing to fly this aircraft given the opportunity? Share your thoughts in the comment section. Remember to subscribe to our channel so you don't miss any future videos, and be sure to explore our extensive collection of articles on our website at plane-encyclopedia.com. Thank you for your support.